On May 9th, 2001, at the National Press Club in Washington, D.C., an unusual and unprecedented event took place. Over 20 individuals from the highest levels of the U.S. military, intelligence and aerospace industries, NASA international air traffic controllers, scientists, radar operators, pilots, and other experts with rarefied credentials and extremely high security clearances all came together to share their experiences concerning extraterrestrials and UFOs. The focus of this conference, put together by Dr. Stephen Greer and the Disclosure Project, was to promote open hearings in Congress dealing with UFO and extraterrestrial phenomena going back over 50 years. It was an astonishing series of testimonies. Here were a couple dozen seriously credible witnesses coming forth on the national stage to talk about the most bizarre events imaginable. Objects under intelligent control doing impossible maneuvers at thousands of miles per hour.
What they did was coalesce and started rotating in a circle and then they disappeared.
Glowing red orbs, disabling nuclear missiles deep underground.
And this time it was a more intense tone in the guard's voice. It was very clearly very frightened. He said there was a bright glowing red object hovering outside the front gate. We lost somewhere between 6 and 8 weapons that morning.
Alien structures on the moon.
And then he proceeded to put photographs down in front of me, and clearly in these photographs were structures, mushroom-shaped buildings, spherical buildings, and towers.
An ET pilot killed on an Air Force runway.
There's been UFOs in the pattern all night. They're on radar. But in any case, an alien had come off the craft and had been shot by a military policeman and apparently was wounded and was heading for McGuire.
Dozens of incredibly surreal accounts right out of a Spielberg film. But the witnesses are all dead serious, highly intelligent professionals of rank and stature, and in fact were in these positions because of their quality of mind and character. Several had concrete evidence to back up their claims and were all willing to testify under oath before the US Congress. Over 30 international news organizations recorded and broadcast the event. The exceptional nature of this gathering and straightforward at times emotional testimonies begged the mind-bending question, what if they're telling the truth? One of these witnesses, an aeronautics illustrator named Mark McCandlish, had several high-level security clearances and worked for organizations such as Rockwell International, Boeing, and the US Air Force. He'd spent over a decade in research and development on the main focus of the NPC event, technologies connected to UFOs and extraterrestrial vehicles. His detailed technical illustration of a purportedly reverse-engineered alien craft, the Fluxliner, a strange flying disc shown at a secret US Air Force air show in 1988, was a highlight of the conference.
These discs were hovering off the floor without any visible means of support. They were referred to as alien reproduction vehicles, also nicknamed the Flux Liner because they used high voltage electricity. This is a diagram that I made based on a sketch that Brad Sorensen did for me in rough form, and subsequently cleaned that drawing up and made it much more accurate.
This is his story.
He says, you know, I gave you the basic verbal description of what I saw. He says, but somehow or other, you've taken everything, all the information I gave you, and you have graphically interpreted into an image that is so close, so accurate. He said, this is really dangerous stuff here.
Thank you. Deanne Divis with United Press International. Could you please address the vehicle that there was a drawing displayed of? Why would this vehicle be on display at an air show? What is the power source that you are asserting is going to be so very useful? And how can you determine that this vehicle is not something that is being developed, you know, by a government agency?
In fact, I think that was the testimony. This is an alien reproduction vehicle, and just to be clear, this means that it is based on advanced anti-gravity and zero-point energy propulsion systems. They are being manufactured by a consortium of companies that include Lockheed Martin, Northrop, SAIC, and other corporations. But this is not a jet internal combustion system at all. It is actually kicked in by a type of electric power source, and it then accesses this ambient zero-point energy field that is responsible for all matter and energy existing, and by special configurations and what have you, it causes a cancellation of mass inertia and an anti-gravity effect. They do have super luminal capacity, in other words, faster than the speed of light capacity. I think Mr. McCandlish and other witnesses, as he's identified, could go into more of the technical physics of it.
My name is Mark McCandlish, and for the better part of the last 30 years, I've been a conceptual artist, illustrator, and designer, working predominantly for the aerospace and defense industries. About 1988, I came into some information that indicated that the United States government was in possession of and operating a kind of anti-gravity technology through a system, an aircraft that was referred to as the Flux Liner, or as the Alien Reproduction Vehicle. The story dates back to the late 70s when I was going to college at Art Center College of Design, studying transportation and automotive design. Had a friend there by the name of who had a number of classes with. I switched over to an illustration major before I left. I spent a short time working in the special effects industry in Hollywood, and then left that job to work in the defense industry for General Dynamics. Spent some time working there as a conceptual artist and designer, illustrating weapon systems, and then after a couple years left that facility and began freelancing throughout the defense and aerospace industry. So that was where it all started.
In the early to mid-1980s, Mark's career as an aeronautical and technical illustrator began taking off as he accumulated a client list including the US Air Force, Rockwell International, Lockheed Martin, Boeing, and respected periodicals such as Popular Science magazine. He became well-versed in conceptual design at the highest levels of the US military, industrial, and aerospace programs, and often called upon to generate classified and highly proprietary material.
At the time, this was around 1985, 1986, and I had been freelancing for about 4 years at that point. Done a lot of work for Lockheed, a lot of work for Rockwell, and a little bit of work for Boeing. And so I was establishing a reputation and had occasion to talk to an awful lot of experts in the field, various parts of the aerospace industry, so I had an idea of what was going on in terms of the technological development that was occurring in the industry at the time. Worked on some conceptual artwork showing cutaways of some of the weapon systems and how the components inside those weapon systems interrelated to one another. I was given a lot of information. Many times I was asked to create illustrations for clients based on just verbal descriptions of what they wanted to see, because a lot of it was conceptual artwork that was supposed to put across the idea that, say, a particular aircraft that they were designing was going to be extremely fast, so it had to have all the sort of dynamic characteristics of what a really fast aircraft would have. And I had an idea of what these things looked like, so I was subscribing to some of the trade publications that were available at that time, like Aviation Week and Space Technology, and a lot of people at the magazines, test pilots, editors, and things.
By the mid-1980s, he was a very successful professional artist living in Rialto, California, he had a full slate of high-profile projects and had become a very sought-after and respected talent in a very crowded field of designers and artists. Despite living in the era of Reagan and disco, things were going very well for Mark. Then, in the autumn of 1988, things took a turn for the weird.
Well, it turns out that this was in October that the magazine hit the newsstand. It was a November issue of Popular Science. It was called the Mach 5 Spy Plane. And a friend of mine from college, Brad, had seen this cover illustration and it opened up to read the story. And he recognized my name and he called the art director. He passed along my phone number, and the next thing you know, I get a phone call, and this fellow calls up and says, "Hi, Mark, it's Brad. And remember me?" And I said, "Yeah, we were in the transportation design curriculum at Arts Center in Pasadena when we studied car design." So we got reacquainted, had lunch together. It turned out that just a few weeks beyond that, a local Air Force base, Norton Air Force Base, was having a big air show. And there was a rumor that they were going to have an SR-71 Blackbird out there, which was still kind of a rare occurrence at air shows to see something like that. And so I invited Brad to come out to the air show, and he suggested that he might be bringing along a client that he was working with. He didn't say who it was at the time, but that he thought that there might be the possibility that we could network some jobs together. So we arranged to meet together, and at the last minute, I got a second call from Popular Science to do yet another illustration. It was a quick turnaround. They wanted it done over the weekend. It was a quick, you know, $3,000, so I couldn't turn that down. And it was for their February of 89 edition, with the cover story being about the X-31, which was an experimental aircraft program. So did that illustration. And Brad went ahead and went to the air show. And when the weekend was over, I was kind of interested in his impression. And I called him up and I just said, you know, "How did you like the air show?" And he just seemed completely different. When I talked to him on the phone, he sounded almost depressed. I mean, it was kind of a strange sort of reaction. And he said, "Well, I don't know. I think I saw something I wasn't supposed to see." And I said, "Well, how's that possible? Everything that's at the air show is sent there and flown there with the intent of putting it on static display, especially for the public. So how could you possibly see something that wasn't intended to be seen?" He says, "Well," he says, I got in to see a display that was a little more exclusive. It was something that was set aside for some top military brass and some, you know, top politicians with clearances. And, you know, the fellow I was with didn't realize at the time that certain, you know, items were going to be on display. And as soon as he realized that here I was without a clearance to see this stuff, you know, he basically said, you know, don't say anything, don't talk to anybody, we'll get out of here as soon as we can." So I asked him, I said, "Well, what did you see that you think is so stunningly, you know, classified that, you know, you'd be in trouble?" And he says, "Well," he says, "there was an example of the first generation Aurora there, which was the aircraft that was the actual second generation aircraft that I did the conceptual artwork for." So he saw the real thing. And so, of course, I was real curious about what it looked like. And he gave me some details on that. And then he described a number of sort of odd-looking hovercraft and troop transporters and things that were, you know, basically just, you know, kind of jazzed up, advanced hover vehicles of one kind or another. And after going through all of this, I said, "Well, even this doesn't sound, you know, all that extraordinary. I mean, you know, is there something else?" And he says, "Well, yeah." He says, "After they had the main little dog and pony show, they pulled back the curtain and there were these three flying saucers over there," and I was just, I couldn't believe my ears. I said, "No, wait, did you say flying saucers?" He said, "Yes." And I said, "Well, what do they look like?" He says, "Well, they were just,
It looked like something from the 1950s, like a jello bowl, flat on the bottom, sloping sides, a little terrace around the middle, and then a dome on the top with all these little bubbles around the top, and a door that looked like something off of a submarine, you know, with the little pins that go out into the frame of the door, and the big wheel that you turn to tighten it, all this kind of stuff.
The smallest one was about 24 feet in diameter at the bottom end of the craft. The medium-sized vehicle was about 60 feet in diameter, and the largest was somewhere between 125 and 130 feet in diameter.
I said, well, what were they doing? Were they just sitting on the floor? He says, no, they were hovering. There wasn't no landing gear, nothing holding them up, cables, it's just they were hovering.
There was a three-star general that was part of the presentation. When they pulled back the curtains and these three flying saucers revealed to the audience that it had brought there to this hangar, this general got up and he was describing these vehicles. He described them as alien reproduction vehicles, ARV for short. They also had a nickname for the aircraft. They called them flux liners. Now, flux is an electrical term for a high electrical charge. So, high electrical charge liner, a flux liner.
And so this was, you know, so he got kind of scared. He stopped talking. And so I said, well, you know, let's have lunch. You know, he was nervous about talking about it on the phone. So I go over there and we start talking. And as he's describing this stuff, he's describing the different features that he had seen. And well, how do you know that? I mean, if you could just look at the outside of the vehicle, how do you know what the inner workings is? He says, well, they had taken some of the panels off the outside so you could see the inside of, you know, what the components looked like. And he said it was remarkably simple. There wasn't that much to it. And I said, you were able to figure out how it worked from that? He said, well, no, they had an easel next to it with a drawing, a cutaway drawing, that showed some of the internal components, how they were arranged with it, oriented to one another. And then they had a little a TV monitor with a tape player below it that was showing this, you know, continuous loop of this thing sitting or hovering over a dry lake bed out in the desert somewhere, and as you would watch the tape, this thing would make went from a hovering position, made these three little sort of hops going to the side, and then as the camera followed it, it just went straight up and disappeared outside. Down to nothing in just a matter of a second and a half or so.
One of the things that this general had said during the presentation, one of the things that really stood out in Brad's mind was that he said that these vehicles were capable of light speed or better. The aircraft looked very old, like it had been around for decades. It had chips in the paint and runs, and you could see fingerprints and smudges and, you know, boot prints where somebody walked up the side of it, this kind of thing. And he said that the paint that was on the outside, it looked like they'd taken a bunch of powdered lead, mixed it into a resin, and then just brush painted it right on the side of the aircraft. It looked like it was slapped together in somebody's garage, you know.
So according to his account, on November 12th, 1988, Mark's friend inadvertently gained access to a highly classified air show, where the featured hardware of the event was real flying saucers. They were really strange looking, but appeared functional and were named to suggest anti-gravity and reverse-engineered alien technology. An official present stated they could travel faster than light. Despite their futuristic performance capabilities, these appeared to be stripped-down, road-worn working prototypes, which had seen practical operation for years. If this were the case, they were crude but tangible proof of concept for a staggering leap in aviation technology. They used extremely advanced electromagnetic or field propulsion, as opposed to solid or jet fuel, nuclear power, or any other commonly known conventional means. It also meant our government and at least one other major defense contractor, Lockheed Martin, had been developing and deploying functional systems along these lines for many years. To both McCandlish and Brad, who'd been working professionally for some time within what they thought were the highest levels of aeronautical design, this odd system was a sucker punch from the future.
Apparently this had had a really, really serious impact on Brad, and he really seemed kind of stunned by what he had seen.
So I, got together for lunch, and I was doing all these idea sketches of what he described to me about how the components were related. And I had, your stereotypical sort of lens-shaped, flying saucer like you see in, more modern movies and stuff. And he said, oh, no, it's real simple. It's flat on the bottom, sloping sides like, a section taken out of a cone, a little ledge, and then a dome on the top. And he said, the dome is actually the top half of a crew compartment that's like a big ball. Pretty sure that was about 12 feet in diameter. There's a central column that goes down through the middle. There's like a flywheel thing on it that, maybe, 6 to 9 feet in diameter. There's four ejection seats that are all back-to-back on this central column above the flywheel type thing. And he says a bunch of oxygen tanks in there. They're all around the bottom. And he said the bottom is this huge capacitor array. It's probably, maybe 12 to 14 inches thick. It's shaved off at an angle on the edges. Looked like it had been put on a big giant milling machine, and they milled off the edges at a 35 degree angle. He said there's a series of these plate capacitors. I said, well, do you think that this is functioning like the Beefeater-Brown effect? Like, these experiments were done back in the 60s with levitating things with, electrostatic fields and stuff. He said, well, that may be it, but he says, they told me, he said, one of the things I saw was that it was using zero point energy. It was using scalar energy. Really?
That's cool, huh? Zero point energy. I save the best inventions for myself.
Well, I've been corresponding with Tom Bearden for about 8 years at that point. We talked many times, mailed letters back and forth, talked on the phone and things.
Okay, so what we have is we have a very strong argument that neither the scalar photon, that is the time polarized photon, nor the longitudinal photon, which is over in three space, are individually observable. But if you somehow can combine the two, they are observable as the instantaneous quantum potential.
And so I had a sense of what zero point energy was about, and there were a lot of talk about longitudinal waves and scalar waves and cyclotronic weapons and all this kind of stuff. And so I've been following this for a while, reading Tom Bearden's work and thing. And so I had a pretty good sense of what Brad was talking about, which he was a little surprised about that I would know this already. So he opened up to me a little bit more and began telling me more and more about it. When Brad finally became frustrated with my questions, he sat down while we were in the office, his office together, and he did this rough sketch, which I still have to this day, 22 years later.
And he just sat down, and right where we were sitting there at his table, he just kind of sketched out with an ink pen on a piece of legal size white paper, and put some little handwritten call-outs around the edges that described, the number of capacitor plates in each one of the little sections that there were. They were so wide at the end, and the crew compartment was definitely about 12 feet in diameter. Just kind of put all these things down as close as he could remember to the way they existed. And so I sat down with all this information, and I just began sort of drafting it out.
It was at this point Mark began putting his formidable skills as a conceptual illustrator to work in uncharted territory. Taking Brad's eyewitness account, detailed descriptions, and rough sketches of the ARV, McCandlish began refining aspects of the components his friend described and piecing together an ever more precise rendition of the craft. Over the course of the next few years, he generated a series of drawings, culminating in the Fluxliner Cutaway Blueprint, one of the most notorious images in the history of ufology, and the mysterious realm of black budget aircraft.
I'm Jesse Ventura, and this is Conspiracy Theory.
This was called the Fluxliner.
This is probably the strangest one you've shown me yet. This actually flies?
It actually flies on the principles of high voltage electrical charges.
This is the original, one of the original blueprints of the alien reproduction vehicle, which I produced in March of 1989. It was put together by accumulating a lot of verbal testimony from Brad and later from a number of other sources, including Ken Sellen and some other people that I talked to who had some contact or information about the vehicle.
For Mark, his friend Brad's initial account was a fascinating story with a degree of veracity and plausibility, worth exploring and doing some research. but was after all just one man's tale of a fairly unbelievable event, concept, and machine. However, this subsequent research led Mark to some other very compelling eyewitnesses, official documentation, including numerous scientific patents, and other sources, such as respected quantum physicists, which finally convinced him of the likelihood that the ARV might be a very real thing.
The first verification of the story that I picked up on the alien reproduction vehicle was around 1991, 1992. It was the first air show at Edwards Air Force Base where they actually had the B-2 stealth bomber on display. And in the course of that air show, I had occasion to join up with some clients from Rockwell International, and they introduced me to this fellow who claimed at the time that he was working with the Air Intelligence Agency. His name was Kent Sellen. He claimed that he had inadvertently seen this same craft at Edwards Air Force Base, North Base facility in 1973. And I said, when, how, where, you know, what were the circumstances?
He says, well, I was a crew chief. He said, I worked on Bill Scott's plane when he was a test pilot. And he says, one night my ship supervisor said to me, you know, go out to North Base. They've got a power unit out there, a ground power unit for an aircraft that's leaking or failed or something, so we need to take a tow vehicle out there, go out, pick it up, bring it back. Well, instead, what happened is he comes up off the dry lake bed, rolls right up on the tarmac, and is going down these rows of hangars. They're all Quonset-style hangars back then. And he stops in front of the first one with the doors cracked, expecting to find this defective ground power unit. And what does he see? He sees this flying saucer sitting in the hangar, hovering off the ground. So I tell him, so, well, what happened? He says, well, this thing, you know, was flat on the bottom, sloping
sides, a little ledge around there, and then a dome on the top with these little glass things on top. Looked like there was a camera under each one. And I said, really? He says, yeah. No, you know, no landing gear. It was hovering. And I said, let me borrow your pen. So I took out a Kodak lens cleaning tissue package that I had in my camera bag. It was the only thing I could think of to draw on. I did a quick sketch of this alien reproduction vehicle as described by my friend Brad Sorensen back in 1988. And I said, is that what you saw? And he says, oh, you've seen one. And I said, no, but I wasn't sure until this moment that the story was absolutely true. And so that was when I knew there was a second point of confirmation.
He says, I wasn't there for 15 seconds and I heard footsteps running up to me. Before I could even turn around and look, he says, there was a machine gun barrel at my throat, another one over here, and he says, a gruff voice says, close your eyes and get on the ground or we're going to blow your head off. So they put a hood over his head, blindfolded him, hauled him off, and they spent 18 hours debriefing him.
He was forced to sign some non-disclosure documents about that, but then was given some additional information about it. Things, details about the ejection sequence for that vehicle and so forth, things that Brad didn't know anything about. So that gave some validity to what he was saying.
In addition to Kent Sellen, there is at least one other witness on record testifying to the existence of what he describes as a UFO at Norton Air Force Base, which may well have been the ARV.
I can discuss Norton Air Force Base, and that as a result of all the military airlift command bases under me for their facilities, that there was one facility at Norton Air Force Base that was close hold. Not even the wing commander there could know what was going on. And during that time period, throughout my career, it was always rumored by the pilots that that was a cover for, in fact, a location of one UFO craft. And the reason for that location was folks that could come out, land at Norton, play golf, be part of a golf tournament, so forth, and during that process could go by the facility and actually see the UFO.
I became so excited about the prospect that this thing really was real and that there really was some technology about it. So every chance I got, I would strike up a conversation with someone I knew in the industry, and I'd ask them if they'd ever heard anything about this. I was talking to a fellow by the name of Paul Shepard, who was a UFO investigator. I felt that he'd have, you know, a little bit more knowledge about the kinds of things that were going on in this area of research. And he put me in touch with a couple of gentlemen, Gordon Novell and George Ulick, who was a physicist with Hercules Aerospace up in Sandy, Utah. and they were very interested in this story.
I started off as an aeronautical engineer when I was in college, and I got real interested in what makes UFOs go, and so I just kind of pursued the trail of the technology as opposed to the aliens and that kind of stuff, and that's all I do is pursue the technology, and I got lucky. Got very, very lucky and got my hands on a cutaway of their bird.
One of them had an ongoing correspondence with UFO researcher Wendell Stevens, a retired lieutenant colonel from the Air Force, who'd participated in sort of these UFO chasing exercises up around the Arctic many, many years ago. So Gordon sent a request off to Wendell Stevens saying, you know, we know we have that you have this big photo archive of all these different UFOs that have been seen over the years. Do you have any photography that even resembles what we're describing in this drawing that I had done? And it turned out that there was a case.
I obtained photographs that were taken in 1967 by a military pilot, Harvey Williams, flying a C-47 for the Air Force at 12,000 feet, approximately 25 miles southwest of Provo, Utah. This particular vehicle matches the so-called ARV in all proportions and respects in terms of the detail of the shape of the craft.
It really bore a striking resemblance to the ARV with one possible exception, and that was that the synthetic vision system, little bubbles that accommodated the camera systems on the outside of this thing, were quite a bit larger than the ones that Brad had reported. And so when I thought back to something that Brad had said, and that was that many of the components on the ARV, like the ejection seats and the camera systems, were all off-the-shelf components. He said that the ones that he saw in 1988 looked just like the little bubbles you see hanging from the ceiling in the casinos in Las Vegas. So when I thought back to the camera systems that were available in 1966, of course, they were much larger than they were in 1988, and so the larger acrylic bubbles seemed, you know, to give some veracity to the photography as it was presented in these pictures taken by Harvey Williams. One of the things that came up in the investigation was the fact that a number of the witnesses starting in 1988 described the vehicle that they saw as looking like it had been around for a long time. Chips in the paint, you know, fingerprints, you know, greasy handprints and that kind of stuff. The material around where the Zeus fasteners brought the panels together all chipped and scratched and stuff like it'd been around for a long time. When I talked in 1991 or 92 to Kent Sullen, you know, he clarified that he'd seen this thing in 1973, which was, you know, what, 15 years or something earlier than that. And then the photographs from Wendell Stevens showed that this thing may have been operational as early as, you know, June or July of 1966. So it certainly supported the idea that this thing had been around for quite a while, maybe even earlier than that. When you look at some of the photography of UFOs, going all the way back to some of the earliest photography we know of, McMinnville, Oregon, for example, you see the same general layout, you see the same general configuration, the flat bottom, the sloping sides, a little dome in the middle, sometimes pointy, sometimes almost like the top end of a cylinder that's been chopped off, sometimes a perfectly round dome, sometimes even, you know, like a cone on the top. So it suggests that, you know, there's many different variants of the system, but the overall arrangement of the components is basically the same. Kept saying to myself, you know, this is just too much of a coincidence. You know, maybe this goes back a lot further than anybody knows.
In fact, in a translation of a Sanskrit text written by a Middle Eastern king in the 11th century, there are references to Vimanas, or flying machines, with a propulsion system bearing a striking resemblance to that of the ARV. Strong and durable must the body of Vimana be made, like a great flying bird of light material. Inside, one must put the Mercury engine, with its iron heating apparatus underneath. By means of the power latent in the Mercury which sets the driving whirlwind in motion, a man sitting inside may travel a great distance in the sky.
One of the things that they describe when you read up on the literature surrounding these so-called Vimanas was the so-called Mercury Vortex or Mercury Turbine Engine.
I see the word Vimana. Can you describe how that relates?
Well, this is something that I spent a lot of time reading up about the so-called Mercury Turbine Generators or Vortex, Mercury Vortex Generators described in some of these ancient Sumerian texts. And so I started looking at the possibility that there had to be some kind of circulation going on in the Mercury itself. So that was the kind of thing that I visualized would be going on inside the chamber.
The central column has a number of components, a couple of counter-rotating cylinders. It sounds very much like the device that the Nazis were developing in the Wenceslas mine in Poland towards the end of the Second World War. There seems to be some evidence that they were trying to develop some kind of an anti-gravity propulsion system or a zero-point energy device.
Apparently, if we're talking about systems using components and processes similar to the ARV, we can't ignore the Nazis.
I think it was Timothy Good published a story, maybe above Top Secret, where he found a researcher who was following developments by the Nazis at the end of the Second World War, and it looked like they'd been developing flying saucers up in Poland in the Wenceslas mine, and they had this thing looked like Stonehenge, where they had all these high voltage cables coming into it and these chains that would hold something down, and they had this thing called the bell, the Das Glocke.
Die Glocke. The bell.
That was down in this mine in Wenceslas, and that it involved a ceramic dome, and it had two cylinders inside with a mercury solution circulating it. And the two cylinders were inside an electromagnetic field, and they were counter-rotating, and they had this mixture of mercury, thorium, and beryllium. Now, it looks like there's a high-voltage electrical discharge that's being sent through the mercury, and that is somehow doing something that enables this anti-gravity effect to occur.
Besides rumors about Hitler's top scientists and the mythology of ancient kings, there were other instances where a central core involving mercury and other components similar to the ARV were reported. At one point, Mark contacted and interviewed possible UFO abductees to gain insight on the technology they may have seen in the alien craft. Something he had in common with McDonnell Douglas in the 1960s, and possibly numerous other corporate and government entities since the 1940s.
I wound up going to my management and telling them, you know, you're not going to believe this, but the UFOs are clearly coming from someplace else. They're clearly manned or humanoided, and the only question is whether we're going to figure out how they work before Lockheed or after. And so, as a result of that, the company at that time, which has now, of course, been bought by Boeing, over several years put in about $500,000 worth of research effort under my direction to study gravity control techniques and also analyze UFOs. We hired a police detective to interview witnesses, abductees. We had experimental work and theoretical work. So it was kind of a fun project.
In the course of all this, it occurred to me that one of the other resources that I might be able to draw on was people in the alien abduction community.
I began to think, you know, well, these people are either crazy or they're really having an experience of some kind. And some of them even talked about implants that were being recovered from their bodies. And so I was intrigued and I thought, well, okay, you know, if any of these stories are true, there might be a chance, however slim, that
if they really were abducted by aliens, they might have gotten a tour of the ship. They might have seen some propulsion system components. And so I heard three of these young ladies being interviewed on a radio station out of Las Vegas. This was sort of the precursor to Art Bell and Coast to Coast AM. It was the Billy Goodman Happening. And he was interviewing Cindy Vodemos, Melinda Leslie, and Alicia Davidson.
Contacted the station. They put me in touch with these three young ladies. I interviewed them individually and, much to my surprise, determined that these young ladies seemed to be bona fide examples of the phenomena with implants that could be seen on medical MRIs. So what I did was I simply asked them to describe what they saw. And without disclosing anything that I already knew about the components inside the alien reproduction vehicle, I found that these young ladies, at least one of them in particular, was able to describe not only components that strongly resembled the ones that were inside the alien reproduction vehicle, but they were also at a higher level of sophistication that actually gave additional clues about how the ARV actually functioned.
Alicia Davidson described being escorted into the engine room and seeing the propulsion system components. And it involved a central column that was made of a transparent glass-like material. She said there was a silvery fluid that was spiraling upward at the bottom of this column, down in kind of this well that was in the center of the spacecraft, was this little tiny flywheel-like mechanism spinning, which matched the ARV also. And this is at a point when this young lady had never seen any of the drawings that I'd done of what the ARV was structured like. I was just, you know, talking about propulsion components in general. But then she said that when you looked across this little well, you know, this lowered floor area in the center of the room, was like a guardrail around it. She stood there. You could look across, and she said it looked like the below the deck she was standing on was this glass-like material with these coils of wire going through it. And they were spaced out in the same proportions as the ones on the ARV. The thing that she said that was most significant was that the column itself was rotating in one direction, and the flywheel was opposite, spinning in the opposite direction. So there was counter-rotation, which is something that's often been reported in UFO sightings. You see components on the craft that are spinning in opposite directions.
Back here on Earth, the scientific community has been busy since the end of the Industrial Revolution. There have been dozens, perhaps hundreds of US and international patents dealing directly with electrokinetics and electrogravitics, going back to the turn of the last century. It would be safe to assume private industry and the military have also been working on a great deal of related applications off the public record. In short, since Nikola Tesla's first experiments with pushing electricity around, mankind has had a thing for anti-gravity.
If you look at these two illustrations, this is a patent that was secured in May 30th, 1967 by James Frank King, Jr., who happened to work with Thomas Townsend Brown in the labs of Agnew Bahnsen. But you can see a striking similarity between the two vehicles. On the one hand, you've got a frustum-shaped fuselage section. You've got a series of coils that wrap around the crew compartment, although the crew compartment in this instance is more of a cylinder. But you also have a central column that goes down through the middle, and you have this capacitor section that's in the bottom. And then you have these little flight control mechanisms here. You know, I find it really remarkable that there's so much similarity between the two objects.
Mm-hmm. And when is that patent from?
May 30th, 1967. It's called a magnetohydrodynamic propulsion apparatus.
And so I started thinking, well, maybe it's like a cyclotron. Maybe there's an electrical discharge from this. Basically, this whole thing looks like a giant Tesla coil. It's got the capacitor array. It's got, you know, a central column that looks like the secondary windings of a Tesla coil. And this might even go back to something that Nikola Tesla discovered back in the 1940s, and, you know, just was was all hushed up, and all the UFO sightings we've ever seen were something that came from Nikola Tesla, not from another planet. And I mean, these are the things that were all going through my head at the time.
So it was really surprising to find all the different sources that I encountered that seemed to provide useful information as to how this thing was made, how it worked, what its energy sources were, and it was all really fascinating to me, and that's one of the reasons I pursued it. It wasn't because I was, like I say, trying to breach national security. I was just insatiably curious about how these things work.
And he said it was remarkably simple. There wasn't that much to it.
The ARV system, for all of its claims of flashy, out-of-this-world propulsion capabilities, was indeed remarkably simple. It could be described as a large-scale, souped-up Tesla coil, designed to negate gravity and inertia, with off-the-shelf navigation and life support systems bolted on, almost as an afterthought. You could think of it as the Model T of anti-gravity vehicles, an industrial dune buggy, or crude hot rod that can get you to Mars in a few minutes. In this version at least, first class seating was still a way off.
From everything I've been able to gather, it helps to understand what some of the components are. There's a large capacitor array on the bottom of the craft. It's in the smallest version, it's 24 feet in diameter. The outer edge of the plates and the capacitor section itself are shaved off at that same 35 degree angle. So you have a series of plates that are progressively smaller as you get higher and higher in the stack. And there's 48 sections that are all set up like that. Through the middle of the crew compartment is a central column that's called the amplifier section that's in the middle of the craft. On the very center point of that column is what looks like a large 9-foot diameter flywheel type mechanism. Then around the belt line of the crew compartment is about a 2-foot wide coil of wire that's embedded in the same glass-like material that the capacitor section plates are embedded in.
And there's a kind of flange or fairing that traps the top and the bottom surfaces of the coil. You can see that it traps it there and at the top. But in between are a series of explosive bolts that run all the way around the craft.
They said above this ledge there is a door out of, your stereotypical cartoon submarine. It has a steel frame that's embedded in the side of this pultruded sphere that makes up the crew compartment. And he said, and it had a wheel on it with little spokes that you would turn like an old, Captain Nemo submarine, with the pins that would go out and lock into the door frame, and it had a seal on it so it'd be airtight.
And then the ejection seats are mounted back to back. There's four of them in the smallest version of the craft, and they're mounted on this central column on a set of rails.
In the event of an ejection, the explosive bolts separate the top and the bottom halves of the crew compartment, and the entire outer sheath of the central column pulls away along with the upper half of the crew compartment and the ejection seats. This crew compartment sphere can actually function as kind of a rudimentary reentry vehicle coming down through the atmosphere, and then once you get, say, below 14, 15, 16,000 feet, the thing will pop a chute out the top, and the ejection seats drop off on these rails one by one, and the pilot can drift down in a parachute or with a parachute. Because this flywheel-like mechanism is turning all the time, the individual pilot or crew members have a kind of a pan that's right below the front of the ejection seat that affords them a place to put their feet.
Now, the control system on the vehicle, on the ejection seat that the pilot sits in, on the one hand it looks like a high voltage potentiometer, or like a rheostat on the one side, that has a couple of big heavy duty cables that come out of it and goes into the central column, and that's basically the amount of power that he has in the system. And on the other side there was sort of an inverted J-shaped piece of metal that came up and over like that, that had a sphere on it. Now on the bottom of the sphere there is a sort of a bowl that's sort of slightly larger in diameter, but it conforms to the shape of this sphere.
Of all the components of the ARV, the navigation system, while perfectly logical and even elegant in its design, has to be the strangest one. It's an entirely unknown paradigm in steering an aircraft or anything else, yet makes perfect technical sense. If one were to make the case for truly alien aspects of the alien reproduction vehicle, this might be the first example they'd use.
The sphere itself appears to be kind of a domed arrangement where you have a number of fiber optic leads that come into the sphere. And for each one of the 48 capacitor arrays, there's a series of sensors that are then used to sort of relay information to the individual plates. And so then, on the bottom of this, you have a bowl that moves around and can be used to convey the commands of the pilot in terms of what he wants to do in terms of shaping the field around the vehicle. And right in the center of that bowl is a kind of laser diode that sends a laser beam up into the underside, the inside of this sphere. And so as the bowl moves, that laser is sort of scanning around on the inside of the different sensors that are responsible for each of the capacitor sections. Then we'll, there's a series of relays that'll open up and close and let a certain amount of energy in or, prevent it from going in. And when it's dead center, it means that all of them get the exact same amount of information. You just go straight up. If you want to bank to the right, then you bank this to the right. It sends, laser signal over to the opposite side of the dome, and it says that the opposite side of the craft is going to get more energy, so it banks in that direction. It's kind of like in a helicopter, in the swash plate of a helicopter. When you want to bank to the left, you create more deflection in the main rotor on the right side so that it begins to bank to the right, or bank to the left, excuse me. So it's kind of the same principle.
Then you have an oxygen supply that's strapped to the lower part of the central column down here in the lower part of the crew compartment. You have a much larger set of oxygen tanks, and these are all pultruded vessels, by the way. There's no steel or aluminum in terms of the oxygen supply in the vehicle. There was also a pair of oxygen tanks under the seat, and that was assuming that maybe you had to eject, when you're at 25 or 30,000 feet and you needed some air to get you from up there down to the place where you'd actually be able to breathe ambient air.
I said, well, were there windows? And no, there weren't any windows. He said there was a thing called a synthetic vision system. And he said there were six or seven of these little plastic bubbles around the top of this thing, one on the very top in the center, and then maybe six around about halfway up from where the ledge was to the very top, and they were spaced at even distances. And he said in each one there was a little CCD camera. So the synthetic vision system was set up so they would take two cameras, and it would have a converging point of focus in those two cameras so that it would just be like looking through a set of binoculars, so you'd have a left and a right eye view, and it'd give you a three-dimensional view outside the vehicle, but with no windows. And the reason for that, apparently, was that this aircraft was using extremely high voltages, and the voltages would ionize the air around the vehicle so much that it would start producing X-ray photons, which are absolutely lethal, so you have to have basically a barrier to protect yourself.
You also have a robotic arm that seems to be blended in with a composite fairing sitting right on the top surface of the capacitor array that has the ability to extend outward with a little air-driven claw that's on the end of it. In fact, I think that the craft's magnetic field or electromagnetic field is probably so powerful that conventional little electric motors probably wouldn't work in this kind of an application.
Where they took the panels off the side of the aircraft is it had Zeus fasteners that were these little quick spin lock things that they put on there to hold the panels. The panels are all like a fiberglass material, it's all composite.
The entire vehicle appeared to be covered with what he's referred to as a goopy lead paint. It looked like little flecks of lead that had been suspended in kind of a resin and just painted haphazardly over the outside of everything on the vehicle, with the possible exception of the door itself and these little blisters that house the synthetic vision system.
So why would it be goopy lead paint?
Well, the theory is that the electrostatic field created by this huge capacitor array and the ionization that occurs just because of the propulsion system might be enough to create a level of ionization around the craft that's high enough that it would produce X-ray photons of its own accord. And so you would want to be able to protect the pilot and the crew members from that radiation. So anyway, that's the general overview of the structure of the vehicle. This is a vehicle that has the ability to travel up to or beyond the speed of light. And part of the reason that it's able to do that is because it exploits the energy form that's embedded in space-time that's responsible for the effects of mass and inertia.
So here we have a configuration of various components, creating a system that's somehow capable of producing and maintaining an insane amount of energy in a concentrated field around the vehicle. This field can be precisely controlled by the pilot with the aid of a basic throttle, an alien steering ball, and a bunch of casino cameras. There's plenty of onboard oxygen, handy if you're off the planet, and a lead coating so the occupants don't get fried in their seats. And a robot arm, in case you need a robot arm somewhere. It looks like a big clumsy diving bell from 1905, but apparently works like a helicopter you can take past light speed. Its beauty and elegance lie in the propulsion system, maybe a really, really fast one that gets around currently accepted physics, one we commonly associate with UFOs.
For anybody who has followed the work of Einstein, or just basic physics, you know, one of the sort of inviolable rules of physics is that there's no material object that can actually go faster than the speed of light. So somehow or other, and I'm not saying we got this from aliens, but they did call it the alien reproduction vehicle, but somehow or other, this simple system that Brad described in these diagrams was able to do this. So I began looking at the scientific literature. I was looking at this scalar energy, anything I could find on zero-point energy, scalar energy, quantum zero-point fluctuations of the vacuum, I think is the more technical physics term that they use in the literature. And it turned out that there really were scientific papers that were being published by a number of different scientists, Hal Puthoff, Bernard Haish, Alfonso Rueda, who just happened to work at Lockheed Skunk Works, by the way. So I started noticing the names and where they worked and what they knew, what they were talking, what they're publishing. And it occurred to me that, you know, maybe these are people who have some insider. So I started looking at that. I started looking at the things that Hal Puthoff had said.
In the middle of last century, physicists made an astounding discovery. And that is what we ordinarily consider empty space isn't empty at all. Even if you go to the far reaches of outer space, it turns out that rather than emptiness, what we call the vacuum is really a seething cauldron of what we call quantum energy or zero-point energy. Zero-point just simply means that even if you froze the entire universe down to absolute zero, froze out all motion where everything would be as quiet as you could possibly get it, this energy is still there. It was predicted by the mathematics of quantum theory, but the numbers were so large. For example, there's enough energy in the volume of a coffee cup to evaporate the world's oceans. It was thought, well, this must be some kind of artifact in the theory. But as time went on, various predictions in quantum theory were verified in the laboratory, and it finally turned out we had to take these numbers seriously.
So I opened up a correspondence with Hal Puthoff, and he was very gracious in taking time to talk to me on the phone, send me copies of the peer-reviewed papers that he had published in Physics Review, Physics A, Physics B, and I couldn't understand the mathematics with all these Greek symbols, and I mean it was really advanced theoretical stuff. But what I was able to follow were the paragraphs that were before and after the equations that explained what all the math was talking about. And so as I went through these papers and I would talk to Hal, he would explain to me, well, this means that this is a certain process, a polarization process that happens in the vacuum of space-time, and when you do that, you have this kind of phenomenon. When you do that, you have this other phenomenon. And the papers that he wrote started to indicate this zero-point energy that's embedded in the environment
was responsible for the effects of inertia and gravity and mass, and the reason why, as you accelerate through space-time, the mass of your vehicle increases.
so in a sense, if you find the right way to do it, you can actually sort of reduce the mass of an object. And if you can do that, then of course it takes less propulsive force to push it around. It means that it can go a lot faster because it's not limited by the amount of mass that it increases to as it accelerates. In fact, it may in fact be a situation where the faster you go, the more energy you have available to continue the acceleration process, and at the same time the mass is becoming relatively less and less and less. So it really enables the possibility of being able to go faster than speed of light without violating general relativity, and that was the most fascinating aspect of the whole thing.
You're drawing energy from the environment, and in the process of doing that, you're enabling the craft to not only demass itself, but use, basically conserve energy by using the flux in the vacuum of space-time as the power source for your propulsion system. So literally, the faster you go, the more energy you have available that you convert into propulsive force, and the lower the relative mass of the vehicle becomes. So it's actually sort of an inversely proportional kind of a relationship.
Most scientists with an instant response would think on special relativity terms and say, well, the velocity of light is a limitation. You can't go faster than the speed of light. And therefore, to conceive of us exploring stars or other people coming here, it's too far. They just can't get from here to there. We might explore our own solar system, but that's probably as far as we're going to get. But the truth of the matter is that in general relativity, that's not the case. There are options there. That limitation now has begun to evaporate due to the new understandings and predictions coming out of general relativity. So that's not the issue.
And so I was starting to learn about the technology and how it might be playing a role in the function of this craft. The craft, of course, had oxygen tanks and stuff in it, so it really suggested that the thing was capable of going out into space. The idea was that somehow this vehicle is able to sort of skirt the law in a way that allows it to do these things that are unheard of. Well, I understood that, you know, there were probably, you know, some kind of a powerful electrostatic field involved with the capacitor array. There was obviously an electromagnetic field that was forming around this ring of wire that ran around the crew compartment, and that would form a kind of donut-shaped or toroid-shaped electromagnetic field with field lines stroking right through the middle of the craft, which happened to be where there was this large central column. Now, the central column was supposed to be the most secret part of the vehicle. Brad didn't seem to know too much about that, but he said that it used mercury in some form. He thought it might use it as a noble gas, vaporized mercury.
The mercury, based on a number of accounts, appears to circulate in a kind of a closed loop system that runs down through the cylinder in the middle and then back up in the space between the inner cylinder and the outer cylinder. And there's a counter-rotation kind of a mechanism that's occurring there too. And at the midpoint is this thing that looks like a flywheel. But in effect, what I think its actual function is similar to what's called a homopolar generator, where you can use the centrifugal forces of a disk, a conducting metal disk that's spinning, to actually throw the electrons in the material out to the edge, where they can be literally tapped off with something that looks like a brush that has conductive bristles. Now, I believe that what happens is that this vehicle develops probably several million volts of voltage, and the sheer power of the electrostatic field that is created in this capacitor array actually has the ability to polarize the surrounding space-time, and it polarizes the so-called zero-point energy that is embedded in the space-time. So it creates kind of a positive and a negative aspect to the status of that zero-point energy that's surrounding the vehicle.
So just to kind of give a little background, the idea of a space warp works on the principle of expanding and contracting space in such a way that allows you to go somewhere very, very quickly.
What this does is it leads to something that was described by Mikhailov Kubieri in his 1994 paper on warp drive, the creation of a warp drive that would not violate general relativity. And one of the things that he was suggesting was that you would be able to engineer a vector or a pair of vectors in space-time that would, on the one hand, cause a compression of space-time ahead of the vehicle and an expansion of space-time behind the vehicle, and that there would be an intervening space between those two phenomena that would pretty much peg your sense of gravity, your sense of inertia, to the environment that you departed from when you initiated this movement.
So, in essence, what you have is you have a spherical event horizon around this particular region that might be called a dynamically engineered local space-time. And this particular region is set up in such a way that it creates these influences in the surrounding metric in such a way that it also creates a vector that goes in this direction. And so it's kind of like having, it's almost like having a black hole ahead of you and an expansion of space-time behind you. But the actual environmental conditions that you experience inside the spacecraft are pretty much pegged to the time and place that you start out from.
So you don't have any sense of G-forces or being moved around. You don't have any sense of acceleration, because the entire pocket of space-time that you're encapsulated in is being accelerated by the vectors that are created around the system. So it's uniformly accelerated. The space-time pocket that you've created, the vehicle itself, the crew, the cargo, everything is moved as one complete package, and so there's no sense of acceleration. But what it allows for, according to Alcubierre's calculations, is what he was calling an arbitrarily large speed, which suggests something in excess of the speed of light at superluminal speeds. So to the person that's inside the vehicle, it may appear that you begin to accelerate away from a particular location, but to the person who's standing outside the disturbed region of space-time, it looks as though you just were gone, just, you know, in an instant.
So this is an ARV, isn't that what it's called?
That's what some people call it. We call it RAM, Replication Alien Machine.
Oh, I see.
Many highly credible reports of UFOs share a few key descriptions of how these crafts behave. They appear to have the ability to accelerate to extremely high velocities at will, far faster than any man-made craft, as if the speed of light maybe isn't any big deal. They can stop on a dime and turn at random angles. While traveling at these crazy speeds, like the forces of mass and inertia, which would flatten anyone in a normal situation, also aren't a problem. And they're silent, without any visible rockets, jets, or exhaust of any kind, like they're pulling the energy they use out of thin air. Superluminal speed, mass cancelling, and ambient field propulsion. All apparently standard in the mid-80s model Fluxliner. This makes the ARV a seriously badass means of getting around, and kind of a missing link between Roswell and one of these.
Once we retrieved, back in the 30s and 40s and 50s, several of these extraterrestrial vehicles and began to study them, we combined that knowledge with knowledge we already had, because remember, we had some people like T. Townsend Brown who were studying anti-gravity quite independent of this issue back in the 20s, 30s, and 40s. But when their information got combined with studying these spacecraft, they figured out, this is how they work.
And according to the latest revelations in quantum physics, all this is possible by tapping into the sea of raw energy we're all just floating around in.
There's plenty of energy in the pure raw vacuum. The new physics since quantum mechanics, the vacuum is a source of energy, but it's a peculiar kind of energy. Let me explain the peculiar kind. When a bird flies in and sits on a power line, he sits on a very high potential. But between his 2 feet, he has no potential difference, no voltage. And so even though from the line to the ground, it may be 100 million volts, the little bird can sit very happily with his feet on this supposed 100 million volt line, and he has no volts across his body. He's very happy and doesn't even know it. Let him touch one of his feet to the slightest thing that has the slightest difference there, and he'll fry to a greasy spot. Now, in the vacuum, we have the same thing. We have an extremely high potential or charge of the vacuum, but we're immersed in the vacuum.
So they were modeling the universe as being sort of this empty, material-free environment that had this energy that was embedded in it, almost like a fluid in a way, that it had all of this potential that you couldn't see until you found a way of driving it out of this homogeneous sort of state of equilibrium and getting to do usable work. I'm trying to remember exactly how I met Tom.
Yeah,
I think we met at a UFO Congress in Laughlin, Nevada for the first time. We'd been corresponding for quite a while.
Now, what is zero-point energy? I'm going to show you many different definitions, but let me quote Nikola Tesla. In 1891, the world's greatest electrical futurist, Nikola Tesla, stated, quote, "Throughout space, there is energy. Is this energy static or kinetic? If static, our hopes are in vain. If kinetic, and we know for certain it is, then it is a mere question of time when men will succeed in attaching their machinery to the very wheelwork of nature. Many generations may pass, but in time our machinery will be driven by a power obtainable at any point in the universe." And so there, ladies and gentlemen, is the basic birth of the concept of zero-point energy.
The real issue becomes, is this new technology something that's so advanced and so far out there that it's really beyond the scope of our modern civilization? Is it something that's so hard to achieve that it requires such a tremendous amount of development that it would cause the economy to collapse? Or is it a real threat to existing forms of energy like oil, coal, nuclear, wind power?
By the mid-50s, they knew that this would be the end of the oil cartels and the international financial petrodollar system. And this is very important. It means that we, Homo sapiens, have the ability to access this so-called zero-point field of energy, which is the ambient field of energy from which all matter and energy is fluxing, and can access that energy and generate all the power we need to run this planet without fossil fuels or pollution.
This stuff really works?
Certainly does.
Oh, well, lots of luck! Oh.
Technologies connected to UFO and extraterrestrial vehicles, if declassified and used for peaceful energy generation and propulsion, would solve the looming energy crisis definitively. Would end global warming, would correct the environmental challenges that the Earth is facing.
When I got involved with Dr. Greer and the Disclosure Project, I was very excited, and it was an opportunity to go to Washington and maybe have an opportunity to talk some real-life politicians about what the potential of this technology might be. I was really hopeful that we would see some kind of a door open publicly, and that the government would show that it was willing to have a conversation, a dialogue about the technology.
September the 11th basically knocked May 9th off the radar, permanently. But it didn't lessen the potential importance of the spring conference or the issues involved. It did, however, allow the Bush administration to spend $1 trillion of our money on a war based on lies.
So, getting together with Dr. Greer, going to Washington, D.C. was exhilarating, met a lot of interesting people. And it made it clear to me that there's a lot more going on behind the scenes than anybody can imagine. I mean, just just the sheer volume of the stories and the accounts, the experiences that these people have had. When taken as a whole, you can see that there's this whole other level of things going on that nobody knows about. And there's a handful of people that may have an awareness, an overview of all that, but how it's affected me, well, that's a good question, because, you know, I can think of a lot of things that have happened to me that, you know, if I didn't sit down and seriously analyze all the facts, I might be able to attribute it or blame it on, you know, talking about flying saucers, talking about the alien reproduction vehicle. When I finally did get around to making a copy of this original drawing in the form of blueprint, I sent a copy to Brad. And one of the first things that he said to me on the phone was, and he wasn't kidding when he said this. He said, "You know, Mark," he says, "this drawing is about as accurate as you can get." He says, "Every detail, every aspect of it is right on the money." He said, "It is so accurate in every way." He says, "This has to be probably one of the most dangerous illustrations you've ever done in your life." And he says, "And if you're smart," he says, "you'll tear up the original, you'll throw it away, and you'll never talk about it again."
When it was all done, the CIA, one of the CIA men told the people they were now sworn to secrecy, that this meeting never happened, and this event never happened.
You don't necessarily write anything down. You don't write anything down. And you keep it to yourself. It's a need-to-know basis only.
Well, I thought, gee, this is something that we have to keep quiet. And that was verified by the chief of security.
So I got the feeling that somebody was monitoring my activity. And there was one point at which I wasn't home at the time. The phone rings. My girlfriend, Michelle, picks up the phone, and a voice says to Michelle, "You better tell your boyfriend to stop doing what he's doing, or he's going to be in really deep trouble." And, you know, then I did.
One by one, I lost all my defense clients as a conceptual artist. And it could have been attributed to my involvement with the Disclosure Project. It could just be that I'm an actual artist with paints and brushes, and I don't work with computers like, you know, some experts that I know. And it may be because there were a lot of people that didn't want to be associated with somebody who talked about flying saucers and anti-gravity and aliens and all that kind of stuff.
The reason it's called Alien Reproduction Vehicle is that it's based on the study of extraterrestrial vehicles, but it is manufactured by human military intelligence aerospace contracting arrangements. We have studied specifically extraterrestrial vehicles which have been retrieved. The breakthroughs in that research have led to applications that have led to the building of this and similar anti-gravity devices.
I mean, you can understand how corporations, and Brad told me that it had a big impact on his life, because when his name started popping up on the internet associated with the ARV story, there were a lot of his Japanese clients that wouldn't have anything to do with it because they did not want any of that kind of reputation tarnishing information associated with their product and their brand. And so, you know, he did everything he could, and I've minimized, you know, my mentioning of his name, except where it comes to, you know, historical documentation of what's happened to him and I and other people I know. But I feel terrible in some respects because, you know, I was encouraged by Dr. Greer to name names on camera, and I wasn't ever really sure what doing that meant in terms of protecting identities or protecting people, other than making some footnote in history that this person came forward, said something, and then whatever happened, happened. I had threats on the phone. I had the IRS come up and take all my money, take all my cars.
In fact, that's what happened to a guy in Canada. He had a machine the size of a shoebox that was supposed to put out enough power to power your home, and it was very unusual. Well, he was very open. He would give demonstrations. He wanted some investor to give him $1 million to sell the rights. And, you know, he was doing all the wrong things.
Sure, of course.
And then one day they came with a SWAT team, surrounded his house, confiscated all his machines, put him in jail, and said, if you want to get out of jail, you have to sign this paper that says you'll not work in this technology any further. So the pretense of why they arrested him, they claimed that he was harboring weapons of mass destruction, terrorism weapons. They create a very time-stable pattern. It's sort of like, look.
Again, 14 times.
By the way, Mel, what's your phone number you're calling from? Maybe
yes,
we should write that down. Okay, because they find it's coming from your end, not from here. Something out of West Coast is causing this.
Okay.
So you might check that out with the police over there.
I noticed clicking on my phone. I'd call someone and my voice would be echoing. There were all these weird sounds, like someone else was hanging up the phone after I'd say goodbye, but I wouldn't hang up, you know. So I had the feeling that I was being watched. You know, I started feeling like maybe I was being followed. You know, there were just, you know, things, you know, cars that would make a number of turns, and then, you know, when you look at them, they'd turn off, you know, that kind of stuff.
And if you've actually heard a couple different stories about people being shut down when they're trying to implement this stuff.
Or killed.
Yeah.
I mean, there's many times I lay awake at night with my 9mm under my pillow, loaded, and I wonder why they haven't killed me. You know, I honestly did.
There's evidence to suggest it's dangerous to become successful in the area of applied zero-point energy, cold fusion, or related free energy technologies. Or it can at least lead to very bad luck. Professor Stefan Marinov, founder and director of the Institute of Fundamental Physics in Graz, Austria, was the de facto leader of the European free energy movement. He fell out of a high window in 1997. Eugene Maloff, an eminent physicist and expert in cold fusion, who apparently had working tabletop devices, was beaten to death in 2004 at the height of his career and the day before a public announcement of his findings. Airy M. de Goys, an inventor of a patented revolutionary clean energy technology associated with the zero-point field, was found nearly dead in his car at an airport in 2007 and died a short time later. He missed his flight to Europe, where he was about to obtain substantial funding for his work. Then there's Mark Tomian, a brilliant physicist and inventor of the patented Star Drive, a system remarkably similar to the ARVs in its use of zero-point energy and related spaceflight applications. He and McCandlish had corresponded numerous times before his unexpected death in his home in 2009. This was 2 weeks after the successful trial of a working prototype for a key component of his system.
And if I woke up tomorrow on the other side of the veil, I wouldn't be surprised, honestly. I really wouldn't. Because I know how serious the technology is. I know that it's real.
The storyline basically is that there's a lot of work going on in the aerospace industry that would indicate that we have black projects that have gone even darker, and that there's work being done on electrogravitic, on scalar technology, etc., that we don't even think that those in Congress or even in the military that approve black budgets are aware of.
I've seen copies of inter-office correspondence among defense contractors that openly stated that they felt the technology was a fundamental enabling technology, that it had all kinds of different defense applications, but it also had a lot of serious civilian applications that would be beneficial to humanity as a whole, to the environment. It seems obvious that someone, perhaps a group, maybe some kind of a rogue civilization within our society has capture the technology, they're exploiting it for their own aims, for their own interests, whatever those might be. There's not a sliver of doubt in my mind that it exists, that it's being exploited in some way, whether it's for intelligence collection, whether it's for logistical support, whether it's for retrieval of raw materials from the asteroid belt. I have no idea why or what it's used for. All I know is that it's extremely advanced, it's being used more and more. I can only say that all the people who've sought to figure out what's going on using the Freedom of Information Act have kind of overlooked the fact that if this was a purely corporate endeavor and not a government-sanctioned endeavor, that it may be one way in which the technology can be completely overlooked and skirt the reach of the Freedom of Information Act. Because if it's considered trade secret or, corporate property, so to speak, or controlled by corporations, it may be possible that they could keep this secret for a very long time. Even with, you know, people actively in the government that know that it exists and maybe have contact with some of these corporate officials that control the technology. So, you know, you're kind of left with, you know, a big question mark as to, you know, where is all this advanced technology going and what's it being used for? You know, I mean, if there was somebody that had this sort of interstellar trade program going on with another civilization, you know, that would be very interesting, but I can't understand why they would want to keep that quiet. I mean, it would seem like such a mind-expanding, enlightening thing for people to know about. Maybe we'd stop shooting at each other and start thinking about how can we get along with the people on, you know, stars or star systems, you know, that are around us. So it's hard to say.
That the outer edge of this large 24-foot diameter disc
causes the phone to ring.
Hello, I'm trying to look cool. Do I look cool? Hey. Yep, this is me on camera. Okay.